Don't forget, I won't forget it. No, never. Come on, help. God, change your life, change your mindset, change your way of thinking, change your way of behavior.
A change.
I'll sit at his feet.
Anybody glad you've been changed? Oh, wonderful change came over. Wonderful change came over me. Oh, he changed. Thank God for my change. Thank God for my change. Change my life, change my walk, change my talk. Yeah.
He changed me. Oh, change.
thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the change. Thank you for the change. Thank you for the change.
Thank you, choir. Jesus. I got a what? I got a reason. 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 Hallelujah. Tap your neighbor and tell him, I got a reason. Come on, tell him, I got a reason. I got a reason. I got a reason. God's been good to me. I got a reason. Woo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I just start thinking about his goodness. Somebody penned a song and said, you don't know like I know. Hey, hey, glory. Woo. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory. I got a reason to praise. If you've never been through anything, if your back has never been against the wall, if you never had some storms, you wouldn't know. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is there anybody in here that had to go through some? Anybody had to deal with some things? Anybody back been against the wall? I don't know how he did it, but somehow he turned a situation around. Sometimes I don't even know when he did it. All I know is that he did it. Woo. My, my, my. And for that tonight, today, I'm grateful that God turned that thing around for me. That God healed it for me. I'm grateful right now. Don't mess with me. I'm thanking God. My wife is here today. God is good. I said, God is good. Ah, thank you. Thank you. Oh, Lord. We're just grateful. You want to testify? Come on, testify, sir.
Praise the Lord, everybody. All I can say is God did it. God did it again. He turned it around. Hallelujah. Oh, bless the Lord. You know, God is just a good God. And if you trust him and if you believe him, it doesn't matter what comes upon you. If you believe God and believe his word, hallelujah. Oh, my God, I'm here today standing on the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. His word has already declared that by his stripes or with his stripes, we are healed. Hallelujah. So I'm not carrying anything that's thrown on me. Hallelujah. I'm casting it all on Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm casting it all on Jesus. Because he told me in his word, hallelujah, that he cares about his children. And if you ask anything in his name, according to his will, that he would give it to you. I said, Lord, here I am again. I'm asking you, hallelujah, to heal my situation. The Lord said, I already knew it was coming. So I got you prepared. And I thank him today. I praise him today. I lift him today. I love him today. I worship him today. My soul is rejoicing in Jesus. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your cards. Thank you for your calls. Thank you for every plate of food you brought in the midst of this storm. I lost my big sister, but God, he carried us through it. And I thank him. I praise him. Hallelujah.
God did it. I said, God did it. I said, God did it. My. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I'm excited. Y'all sit down a minute. Let me just talk to you just for a few minutes. Glory to God. Thank you. Glory, 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 glory. Glory, glory, glory. Glory, 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 glory. Glory to God. I hear Joseph said, what the devil meant for evil, God will make it good. He turned it around for our good. Sister Pamela Mason, where you at? Stand up, Pamela. That's, amen. Bishop Younger's brother, Arthur, little Arthur's granddaughter. Amen. Let's thank God for her. Family folk. Amen. We thank God for you and for all of our visitors that are here today. We just a church that love to praise the Lord and give God glory. Amen. We don't try to do it all traditionally. You don't never know. We get the choir. We get a singer. We don't know what we may do. The Lord just whatever God want to do, we. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. If you have your Bibles, just for a little while, turn with me, please, to the book of St. Luke, 17th chapter. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Go St. Luke, the 17th chapter. My God. Beginning at verse number 11. Man, I enjoyed that choir. Yeah, they could have sung 3, 4, 5 more songs. I'll just come back tonight and just do a concert. What about that? Just come on. I don't know, all y'all just come on back tonight and sing about 6, 7 songs. Let's bring them back. Good gracious alive. I want to speak to the young people this evening, and I want all the young people and older folk, everybody who want to come back, come back. Choir, y'all come on back too if you want to. Everybody. Amen. I want to talk to young people this evening, and I'll tell you what I'm going to talk about. We're going to talk about passion this evening. All right. But today, let's go to Luke 17, verse 11. And it came to pass, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, go show yourselves unto the priests. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at his feet and giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. He fell down on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God, save this stranger. And he said unto him, arise, go thy way. Thy faith has made thee whole. Father, thank you today. Thank you for your kindness, your love, your grace, your compassion toward us. We thank you for this service. We thank you, O God, for the time that you've given to us to give you glory and praise and honor. And Lord, we thank you, O God, for touching Sister Bender's body. We thank you, God, for your healing power. We thank you for touching the saints and healing the saints. Thank you, Lord, for doing the miraculous in our lives. And Lord, continue to do, oh God, and help us. Bless you, touch your word, Lord. Help us, oh God, that we declare, oh God, what you've given to us to say today. We give you the praise. We give you the honor and glory. Speak to us. Give us clarity of thought and speech. Help us, Lord, to declare your goodness. And we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank God for his word. Today, I usually say for a little while, but I got to say for a little while today. Time is passing. And in these particular scriptures that has been read here in your hearing, and God says, when Jesus was said unto them, amen, go show yourselves to the priests. Scripture says, as they went, they were cleansed. But the one thing, and one of them, when he saw he was healed, turned back, and with a loud voice glorified God, fell down on his face at his feet, giving thanks, and he was a Samaritan. I just want to ask you a question, if I may. When was the last time you gave him proper thanks? When was the last time you gave him proper thanks? It is one thing to be glad for something or to accept something. But when it comes to being thankful is not just a real thankful. It's not just saying thank you. A real thank you starts from the inside. And have I said to you before, I came up every summer, we would go to the country, down in the country of Alabama, and stay with my grandparents. And they didn't have all the conveniences of that we have here. They had electricity, but that was about it. Amen. If you wanted food cooked, you had to go cut some wood. Amen. If you wanted some water, you had to go to the spring. And with no water, with no running water, so with no bath, you had a big number 2 tub if you want to take a bath. And so it was understanding that the conveniences of that day, or while we lived there, was not like we have them here. But you know what? Even in that, it was something about that really brought something in our hearts that poured into us. It gave us something to look differently at
from the conveniences that we have now. They didn't have any stores. You couldn't go to the grocery store. The grocery store was in walking distance, but it took about 2 or 3 hours to go. And so, you know, if they went to the grocery store, they had to stock up, you know, because you couldn't just, we ain't gonna just take across the street and walk. And all the houses were a long way off from each other. But I bring all of that up to say, because they piggybacked on each other. They needed each other, because even though they didn't go to the grocery stores at the same time, but they ran out of things at a different time. And so the convenience of it, everybody loved each other because you needed each other. That's important to know. See, because if we understood how much we need each other today, we wouldn't be doing all the things we do now. And so they understood that they had a need for each other. And so when they were getting ready to cook or whatever, when one ran out of something, they had to go to the neighbor to get that thing that they were out of. And maybe the neighbor was out of something and something different. And so they would come to us. But I brought this up because it was how our grandparents taught us when they needed something. If my grandmother needed a cup of sugar, amen, to go in her food that she didn't have or had run out of, and she had to go to the neighbor, we had to go to the neighbor and pick up what she need. But she taught us a proper way of asking for what you need. And so they taught us to say, Grandma said, or whoever, my grandma's name was Rosa, but Grandmama said, thank you for a cup of sugar. So we would thank them before we got it. They taught us to say thank you on the front end. So Grandma, it didn't make sense, you know, but Grandma said, thank you for a cup of sugar. It brought up two things. It lets you know I'm grateful for it, and then it also brought up faith, because I'm saying I believe you got it. I'm letting you know before you even give it to me. Grandma said, thank you for a cup of sugar. And every time they needed something, somebody had something. And they would reciprocate the same thing. And so everybody learned how to say thank you, until you get it down inside of you that thank you was just not something you said off the cuff, but it was something that you said because you really needed. And because of the need and for the food to be complete, we have to say thank you for what we need. And so we learn the value of being thankful on the front end of while we were young, because you just couldn't go to the store across the street. And so you needed it, and God made a way for you, but you had to learn to be thankful. But I'll tell you, we're in a society now that's not thankful, not grateful. Amen. Even the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy 3 through 10 and verse number 2, it talks about the days of how the days are going to come. It says men shall become boasters and high-minded and high-headed. And then it goes on to say men shall become unthankful. And so we're in an unthankful time. The situation is, the reason why things are the way they are now is because man has forgotten how to be thankful. And thankful is, like I said, it's not just something on the outside, but thankful causes you to think. When you are really thankful, you have to think that the fact that is, I need something better than what I have for myself. And so now what I must do, I must learn how to be grateful to the one who provides for me. And so now Grandmama then was asking people for stuff, but ultimately it was not folk that was providing, it was the Lord who was providing. Your every need, God provides it for you. The problem is, we've forgotten that it was the Lord, it is the Lord who makes a way for us. It is the Lord that woke you up this morning. It's the Lord that started you on your way. It's the Lord that, even though some of you didn't set your clock right and yet you got up late, but even in that, God woke you up. Wasn't it a thing that you did on your own accord? It wasn't that alarm clock that really woke you up, because there were many people who had alarm clocks and they sounded, but they never got up.
is because we have to know that when God says it, he means what he says. And look, and even in the scriptures, down through, we look at in Romans, it speaks about how the things of the times were coming in that day, how wicked, amen. It goes on, it says now, how they said men, the reason why men get in such a depraved and have gotten in such a depraved and bad state, it's because now, it goes on how it says God turned man out, turned them over. He turned man because man started doing stuff that was inconvenient, started going after strange stuff and going after things like, you know, the society going after now. And so he said these things are abominable and they are downright disgusting to God and they stink in his nostrils. So how did man get in this place? Well, if you really want to know, it goes back into verse 21. He says now, because when they knew God, when they glorified him not as God. Y'all know a whole lot about church, but that don't mean because you know a whole lot about church that you glorify the God who has given us what we need. So we find many people who say they don't need church no more. The society now said we don't need to serve God. Or we are educated now. And so we don't really need that like we used to. And so because a man's inability or a refuser to give God praise and glory like he should have, the Bible says when they knew him, they would not glorify him as God. So God, and so because, let me just read that right quick. Hallelujah. In Romans chapter number 1 and around verse 21, he says now, because these things are important for us to know, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, but here's the little piece right there that we run past. But it says neither were they thankful. You see that? Neither were they thankful. Forget how to be thankful in the right way and thankful the way God wants us to be thankful. We lead ourselves into a bad place. You can't do, you can't get nothing from God, hallelujah, the way God wants it to. You can't get the Holy Ghost without being thankful. I said you can't get the Holy, let me say that again. You can't get the Holy Ghost without being thankful, because while you are saying hallelujah, I'm saying thank you, Jesus, God takes over you, and something that the Bible says, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. In other words, something has to take over you. There has to be a thankfulness that spring up out of you in order for you to get the Holy Ghost. You can't be mad and get the Holy Ghost. You can't be upset and get the Holy Ghost. You can't be talking about folk and get the Holy Ghost. But if you want God's best, you got to humble yourself and be thankful. So he says that it is our duty to be thankful. I'm trying to hurry on here. It's our duty to be thankful. God wants us to know that he wants us to be thankful. When you look through the scriptures in Psalms, it deals with us and telling us to be thankful unto God. It tells us that we ought to give God his due, because if you don't, you'll leave yourself dormant. There are Psalms 105, verse 1 says, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people." Hallelujah. If you're going to praise God, you got to give him thanks. And David in the scriptures here was just, he was saying to tell us to give God thanks. He began to just keep on telling God thank you. Hallelujah. In 107, he says, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever." And so we have to learn to give God thanks. And in our text now, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. But there, as he was on his way, he had to go through Samaria and Galilee. And so while he was going there, but when you take a real good look at the geographical location, he didn't
have to go through Samaria and Galilee, but there had to be something there that caused him to detour. Sometimes when you need God, you have to learn how to have a heart of thanksgiving and a heart that tells God, I have a need that only you can feel. And God, he knows how to detour to your situation. You have to learn how to open your mouth and tell God, I'm in need, and you're the only one who can help me. And so God, Jesus was going on his traveling into Jerusalem. Well, between Galilee and Samaria, he looked and there were 10 lepers, 10 lepers who saw Jesus afar off, and they begin to lift up their voices and tell him, Jesus, Jesus, have mercy, thou son of David, have mercy. Is there anybody in the room that ever needed some mercy? Is there anybody in here have ever asked God, I need mercy, the situation I'm in, I need mercy, I don't need money, I need mercy, don't need no friends, need mercy, don't need a big name, just need some mercy. There's some times in your life that you're going to have to learn that you're going to need some mercy. Mercy more than money. Mercy more than prestige. Mercy. And so they were calling him because they were in their own space. 10 lepers who hung out together, because in the time leprosy was something that caused you to be quarantined. You couldn't hang out with everybody when you were a leper, because leprosy is a type of sin. Sin is something you can't get rid of by yourself, because leprosy, it may show up on the skin, but it goes deeper than the skin. It is something, and the scripture says to Israel. And so now, anybody in Israel, if you had leprosy, according to Leviticus 13, you had to go show yourself to the priest. He was the only one. He declared it, and if it was not there, he declared it's clean. And so you couldn't just declare yourself clean. You needed somebody else to declare, because when you messed up, you can't do it by yourself. That's the problem with a lot of church folk. You know you messed up, but you kind of fix it yourself, but you can't fix yourself without Jesus. You can't handle it, you can't fix it. I know too many times we tell people, you need to come on to church and get yourself right. And they say, I would come, but I got to fix some things first. They missed the point. If you could fix it yourself, you would have already fixed it. But because you can't fix it, when your sin has gotten a hold of you, you need something that's able to eradicate sin. That's why you need the power of the Holy Ghost. That's why you need to be baptized in Jesus' name, because that's the only name that will remit your sin. The only way you can get rid of sin, you can't pray it out. You got to do it God's way. You got to repent of your sin, die out to it, be baptized in Jesus' name. And then you need some power. That's where the Holy Ghost come in. It's that dunamis power that's able to blast sin out of your life. What is that power? The power of the Holy Ghost is Jesus living on the inside of you. So if you're going to get it right, you got to do it God's way. And so leprosy, being a type of sin, they had, hallelujah, instructions for those who had leprosy. Number one, he says, now after showing yourself, then you have to say, in a quarantine position, and you have to, before you go around anybody, you have to open up your mouth first and say, unclean, unclean. In other words, you're telling folk, don't come near me. The disease I got is contagious. Don't come near me. Unclean. Wouldn't it be good if you could have folk now to say, unclean, unclean. Sister, I'm trying to holler at you, but don't turn to me because I'm unclean. Wouldn't it be good if he told you up front, I'm going to tear up your life, I'm going to lie to you, I'm going to cheat on you, I'm going to talk about you, I'm going to walk off and leave you. Unclean, unclean. I got a problem. I wished I could help myself, but I can't help myself. But when Jesus saw these lepers men, he said unto them, hallelujah, go show yourself to the priest. Hallelujah, he declared, you're clean. But he says, go show yourself. The Bible says when they walked away, they didn't see any signs now, but as they went, when you do what God wants you to do, you may not see the signs just yet, but if you're obedient to his word, as you go, God starts straightening out. God starts fixing things. God starts turning things around. God starts changing things in your life. I came to tell somebody, if you ain't seen no signs yet, if you say and do what God say, just do what he says, he will, after a while, as you go in obedience to his word, he will fix it, he will change it, he will touch it. And the Bible says, as they go, hallelujah, the thing, the sin, the situation that we're dealing with, because leprosy was so severe, when it gets so bad, your skin would all dry up, your fingers could fall off, and there's still leprosy in certain parts of the world today that's still going on. It's a part, it's accounted as sin. I tell you, there's things in sin that'll mess up your life. Sin will take you down. Sin will cause you to lose your mind, to lose your relationship, to lose your integrity, to lose your character. Sin will cause you to hate yourself. Sin will take you lower than you plan to go. It'll take you further than you plan to stay. But I came to tell you, when Jesus comes, he knows how to take away your sin. He came that you might have life. He came to give you life more abundantly. And he told all 10 of them, go show yourselves to the priest. And as they were going, they saw how God had cleaned them up. They saw how God had changed them. They were able to see something new in their lives. They were able to see that God had done a miraculous work in their mind, in their lives. Well, the Bible says that all 10 of them went and were healed, got their healing. Well, and 9 of them went on rejoicing because of their healing. And ain't nothing wrong with it, because that's what Jesus told them. Go show yourself to the priest. But there's somebody that's in the room is like this Samaritan. This Samaritan, you knew the Samaritan hated the Jews, and the Jews hated the Samaritans, they didn't have anything to do with each other. Even Jesus said in Luke the chapter, he said, don't have anything. Don't even go near the Samaritans. But this Samaritan was in the bunch. All 10 of them had an environmental problem because all 10 of them had gotten leprosy. Somehow, you hang sometime with the wrong folk because leprosy is contagious. I heard the word say, hallelujah, don't be yoked up with everybody, because sometime who you hang with, the scripture says evil communication corrupts good manners. I heard the word say, don't be yoked up with unbelievers. They'll turn your mind against God. They'll turn you away from serving God. I wish I could get you to hear me. Somebody in the room, you've been running with the wrong crowd. Hey, you used to love God. You used to love church. You used to love to praise him. But now you've been running with the wrong group. And now you keep finding fault. You find fault with everything and everybody. But I came to tell you, you better move away from them and tell God, it's you I want and you alone. Hey, Lord, they all had an environmental problem because of leprosy. Hey, but God cleaned them up. Well, now, in these last 10 minutes, maybe even 7, I want to say here, but there was one who came, who looked at himself. He can see healing has taken place just like the other 9. He can see that God has done something miraculous for him. But then he think about, I'm not like everybody else. I'm a Samaritan. God said, I wasn't even supposed to be healed. He didn't only have, hallelujah, an environmental problem. He had an inherited problem, an inheritance problem, because he came here, hallelujah, being a Samaritan. He came here being a Samaritan. He didn't choose to be a Samaritan, but he came here one. I hear the scripture said, we was born in sin and shapen in iniquity. All of us was like that one, that Samaritan. Our lives was messed up. Adam messed us up in the garden. We didn't have no hope. We had nothing to bargain with. You didn't live good enough. You didn't have enough money. Didn't have enough talent. But the Lord healed you anyway. The Lord pulled you out of the miry clay. Place your feet on a rock to stay. The Lord saw fit to save you. Some of you, you had nothing to deal with. Wasn't no preachers in your family. Some of us live, hallelujah, wretched lives. We didn't deserve. Some of us was low down. Some of us was cigar smokers, cigarette smokers, gamblers and thieves, whoremongers and liars. Hallelujah, walk the street. But look what God has done. When you look at yourself and see that the Lord saw fit to bring you out when you didn't deserve it. Some of us should have been dead a long time ago, but God, he had mercy on you. God, he looked past your fault and saw your need. Some of us were sneaking, dodging and diving.